Hello everyone. In this video I want to share what I consider to be the 10 most important things you should know when tracing over a sketch in Inkscape. I'm not the best draftsman, I've said that many times before, so I often start with a quick sketch on my tablet, and then I refine and fix the mistakes in Inkscape, where I feel more comfortable. Over time I've learned a variety of tools, tips and techniques to improve this process, and I wanted to share them with you in this video. These tips follow the natural workflow of tracing, starting with broader concepts and then moving into the more specific areas of 2D rendering, so make sure to stick around until the end for the most exciting stuff. One last thing before starting, if you want to support the channel, make sure to like and leave a comment. Also consider subscribing for more videos on Inkscape and illustration. If you want to further support the channel and learn more about character design using Inkscape, consider checking out this bundle of 5 courses, where you'll learn everything you'll need to draw characters like this pirate, and more. Link in the description. That was all, now continue with the video. The first thing to think about after importing a sketch into Inkscape is what method of tracing you're gonna use. I've talked about this before. There are two methods of tracing you can follow. One will be using shapes, like a traditional vector illustration, and the other will be using lines with the pen tool. Like if you were tracing over using an actual pen, without thinking about the feel. The two of them have their strengths and drawbacks, but generally speaking, using shapes is more difficult and slower. You have to think where and how to connect the shapes, and depending on the sketch, a few complexities that you didn't expect may arise. But it also gives you much better control if you need to adjust something or deviate from the sketch. You'll need to follow this method if you want to animate your sketch with a skeletal animation software. On the other hand, the lines method is much faster, and you don't even have to think about how the shapes connect. You'll end up with a line skeleton, just like this, but that's easy enough to fix using the bucket tool. The problem is that once it's drawn, it's much difficult to adjust, and if you don't want to use line art, then things get a bit more complicated. In any case, I always recommend to use the shape method for most of your traceovers. That is the natural way of work using vectors. But if you have a solid sketch and you don't plan to animate it later on, then the lines method may be easier, faster, and end up with the same results. I found this one essential to trace over anything. If you open the Layers and Objects dialog in the Layer menu, you'll notice that you can lock any object, including importing images, using this little lock. You can also lower the alpha so it's easier to draw on top. But one thing that always bothers me is that once you start drawing with filled shapes on top, it becomes harder to see. The shapes block the sketch. There is an easy solution that I always use. Assign the sketch to a layer, lower its opacity, and very important, use a little lock to lock it, then create a new layer where your trace over is gonna be, and send it below the sketch layer. Because the sketch layer has a lowered opacity, that means that you can see through, and because it's locked, that means that you can work through as if it didn't exist. Just be mindful when sampling colors, because the dropper will sample this layer. If you want consistent colors, consider just pasting the style, which we'll see in a minute. I mentioned that since I'm not the best draftsman, I like to fix the mistakes I make inside of Inkscape. I do that all the time with most of the illustrations I make, but I don't just use Inkscape for fixing mistakes. I also use it to try new things. For example, I didn't like the hairstyle here. I wasn't convinced when I imported the sketch in. I thought to see if I could find it as I was drawing in Inkscape, but that didn't happen. So I moved away a lot more from the original design, and I completely changed the hair. It was easy since I already had everything else made. That happens all the time. Sometimes something looks great in the sketch, but it just doesn't translate well to Inkscape for multiple reasons. I also wanted to mention one specific type of fix I often do. I'm not good drawing hands, so I often sketch them like this, very rough and undefined, and I leave the problem for future me, for Inkscape me. Well, I wanted to mention an amazing tool I've been using for a while now that has completely solved my problem with hands specifically, but also with other complicated parts of the body, and that is Design Doll. Design Doll is a free tool that allows you to pose a 3D mannequin and change its proportions and shapes. It's really powerful. Regarding the hands, It has this very easy to use UI to handle the position up to individual fingers, so it's not hard to pose the hands in the way you want, and then export it to Inkscape and then just trace it. It's really a wonderful and easy to use tool, and I strongly recommend you to use it, not only with hands, but also with the rest of the body. So check it out, it's called Design Doll. Let's talk about colors now. There's a really nice way to pick interesting colors that I've been trying out lately. I've been playing around with pre-made palettes. If you go to a site like colorhunt.co or colors.co, you'll find a ton of pre-made palettes that have interesting and unique colors that just work together. I like to start by picking a palette and then moving it into Inkscape. From there, I just sample and adjust. This won't usually give you all the colors you need, but you can use it to get the most important elements. Don't be afraid of adjusting the colors either. Consider the palette more as a base or source of inspiration. If you have everything set up correctly, then it's not gonna be hard to just play around with different color variations and pick your favorite. In many styles, like for example in the Disney style, the color of the strokes matches the fill inside of the area, as a way to soften up the harsh line. To do this, you give the stroke the same color of the area they had in contact, but darker, and that's about it. There is this problem that is bound to happen if the character is relatively complex. A stroke may be making contact with multiple different filled areas. In Inkscape, you cannot apply more than one color to the stroke of a single object. This has an easy solution using the node tool. Go to the areas you want the color separation to be, and add nodes by double-clicking. Then select the stroke and use this button that says Break Path at Selected Nodes in the tool controls of the node tool. This will separate the stroke at the selected nodes into different islands. The next step is to separate the different islands into different objects by going to Path, Break Apart. And now all of these strokes are different objects which you can apply different colors to. I demonstrate this technique all the time in my tutorials, and more than a technique, it's just an effective way to do something. When making shadows, you not only have to adjust a particular color, but also a particular alpha of a shape. That means that you cannot just sample with the dropper to get the right color of a shadow. You have to go in manually and copy the exact colors and alpha. But there is this really helpful tool that allows you to copy the exact colors and transparency of a shape, and then apply them to another completely different shape. It's called Paste Style. Just copy the shadow shape as normal, you can use Ctrl-C, and then select the new shadow shape and hit Ctrl-Shift-B. The shape will be intact, only the color and alpha will be copied. This means that you can really work fast when making shadows, just drawing and then hitting Ctrl-Shift-B. It really saves a lot of time and makes the rendering a much more agile process. Let's say that you want to give it a more three-dimensional look to your drawing, like one of those posters where the shadow is smooth. The easiest way to do this is to use the blur slider in the fill and stroke dialog. Now depending on how you work, you will have to follow another step. The problem is that smoothing the shadows messes up the area where they are. You'll need to use a clip. Then with the node tool you push the outer edge outside of the clipping path, so the soft area is where you want it. You may need to enable Show Path Outline so it's easier to handle the nodes of the shadow. If you watch my tutorials, you'll know that I love to give my characters this thick outline like the cartoons from the 90s and early 2000s. There are many ways to do this depending on how you made the character, but the easiest way is to go to the Pocket Tool. In the Tool Controls, make sure this drop-down is set to Alpha, and make sure the character is set against the canvas, not against a solid shape. Then zoom in as much as you can while fitting the entire character in the drawing area. This is important because the bokeh tool uses pixel information, and it will be more accurate the more you zoom in. Then click inside, and a new shape with the silhouette of the character should have been made. Now, if you pay attention to this shape, it's not 100% correct, and the nose will be quite funky, but it's usually good enough for what you want to do. Anyway, move the shape to be below your character and give it a thick stroke. Now, because the stroke is thicker, chances are that you're seeing more of those poorly generated nose that messes up the outline. In those cases, you'll need to go into the shape with an old tool and delete and adjust manually any problematic node. This one is something I've been experimenting with some characters. Coloring ramps can give it an extra something to some designs. This is just a gradient applied to the silhouette shape that we made in the last tip, only that this goes on top. Just mess around with the colors and the overall opacity, and of course the color modes. It certainly does not fit all characters or styles, but I found that it can add something extra to the design if it's well done. However, it does require some heavy messing around to make it work. But what if you want further control over the rendering of a sketch? In those cases, I would recommend to using a pixel-based software like Photoshop or my personal favorite, Krita. Even if you don't have a tablet, you can move the line art, or maybe the line art and the colors, to Krita, or whatever you're using, and then finish it with a more expansive toolset to handle colors and textures and layer styles and all of that. I'm not sure how to do this in Photoshop, though I imagine it's more or less the same, but for Krita, you just copy an Inkscape group containing what you want, and then paste it inside of Krita. This will create a vector layer that you can make bigger and smaller, and it won't lose quality, like vectors. But if you want to start giving it proper color, you'll need to transform it into a pixel layer, which is easy to do. I don't want to go in depth here. I could make an entire video on how to combine Inkscape and Krita, but do let me know in the comments if that's something you'd like. And that was it for this video. I hope you learned something new, or at least have fun watching. Remember to like, comment, and subscribe to support the channel. Also, don't forget to check out the courses bundle in the description. That was all for now. See you next week. Bye.